What?
Yes. Shall I proceed?
Yes, sir. You can proceed.
Okay. So the miner has to solve the puzzle, generate the block, and then further forwards it. So am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So now you can see this is the content what is there in the blockchain. You can see that previous hash, timestamp, transaction route, and then nonce. So what is this previous hash is? For example, let's consider this block. So the previous hash means the hash of this block is the previous hash. And the timestamp, that is the Linux timestamp of the machine where the miner has mined the block. And definitely there is a time difference, but what they say is there is some time bound defined. So what is the time bound is, that is the time of the previously received 10 blocks, that is the average time of the previous 10 blocks, that is the minimum bound, and the maximum bound is the time of the neighbors, that is the average time of the neighbors plus 2 hours. So up to that range, if any block comes, user will accept, otherwise they will not accept it. So I hope this one is clear, because the timestamp of each and every machine is different, and if you are looking for the block or transaction on particular time, then that is not possible. Those they said the time bound. What is the time bound is the lower bound is the I said average. It is not average. That is the median of the previous 10 blocks time, and then the upper bound is the neighbors time, that because we know the neighbor's timestamp, it's average plus 2 hours. Okay, so this will be the lower and upper bound for the block that can be received by any of the users. If it is violating this, then the respective block or transaction will be discarded. And you can see this nonce. So this is very important. What is this? Is number one's use. This will be used for solving the puzzle. And here you can see the transaction route, as we were discussing in the beginning. The Merkle tree route is the transaction route. You can see in this place that is placed here. So the transaction route, previous hash, and timestamp, along with the nonce. The nonce will be any value that will be given to the hash function, and it has to produce an output. And that output should be less than a defined target. If it is less than, that means the miner has successfully solved the puzzle. Otherwise, it is not solved the puzzle. So they have to change this number. So let's say all these are fixed, a previous hash, timestamp, and transaction route. After that, they try with nonce as 1. They give it to the hash function, see the output if it is less than the threshold or not. If it is not, then change the nonce to 2, then 3, then 4. Till they get the hash output less than the threshold, the process has to go on. That is why it takes a lot of time. And this process is defined in the consensus protocol, which is called proof of work. So in this way only the Bitcoin blockchain is represented. And the header part, if you see, you can see here only 1, 2, 3, 4 are mentioned, but you can see there are so many things given. Okay, that is the version is given, the previous block hash that we have already seen, Merkle root we have seen, timestamp we have seen, and nonce we have seen in this picture. But the other parameters are missed in that. That is the difficulty target and version. Okay, these two are missing. So what this version says is the version is the blockchain version. I think right now it is 0.1.4 something. So that is the version, and this is the difficulty target. I was talking about that less than some target, right? That will be available in this. So here we can say, in addition to this, the target will also be there, and then the version will be there. And very important thing, the block number will also be there in the blocks of, or the blocks in the chain. Otherwise, we will not know which block number we are working on or which to be worked on. So this is the header. And already I told you that it is processed using the unspent transaction output, not on the balance. So this is the transaction. If you see, let's take that this is one transaction, and using this transaction, the new transaction is made. So now what happens is that what is that UTXO is unspent transaction output, that will contain the list of transactions which are not yet paid. So please remember, that will contain only the transactions which are not yet paid, and that pool will be available with all the participants, whoever is going to take part as a full node. And this is also part of the UTXO, let's say at one point of time. Once the transaction is prepared, that is, this transaction is prepared, then what happens is, this particular transaction will be removed from the unspent transaction. So that means no more this transaction can be spent by the so-and-so user. In that way, they avoid the double spending. And now this transaction become part of the, we can say that as the unspent transaction output. So here you see what is there in the transaction, that is the attributes of the transaction. First is the version number. So again, if they are making any change in the transaction, accordingly the version number will change. And next is the flag. It will be mostly zero. In some cases, it will be one. In that case, there is a witness present, otherwise it is not there. I will talk about this witness little later. And then it has two part. One is the output part, sorry, input part, and another one is the output part. So what is there in the input part? You can see previous transaction hash, because one transaction can be spent based on the previous transaction. It is not that directly some transaction can be spent or created. So, but there are some transactions which will be directly created. I will talk about that. So here the previous transaction hashes, that is, this transaction is created based on this transaction. The complete hash of this is available in the previous transaction hash. Next is the previous transaction out index. So as I said, there will be two parts in the transaction. One is input part and output part. So input means that is spent. The output means that new coin is available. So here you can see the output contains two transactions, that is, one is of index 0 and index 1. Which one this particular transaction is going to use? That is index 1. So that will be here. You can note down that. And you can see the script length and the script. So what this contains is, this contains the public key of the sender and the signature. Signature and public key will be available in the script. So the length of that will be available in the script length. So why they are calling this as the script is, there is some protocol written, or we can say the procedure written. Okay, according to the procedure, the script will be read. Accordingly, the signature will be validated. So that's why they have used the term script here. Next is the sequence number. If there is a sequence number given to the transaction, what is that sequence number here mainly means? Let's say I want to go for some fixed deposit kind of thing. Okay, so in that I have to mention how many sequence number it has to go, after that it has to be spent, or what is the sequence number of the transaction, that particular transaction link. For example, I have a transaction, and that transaction is spent on other transaction, and that transaction is spent on other transaction. So it will be keep on going. So the sequence number will be maintained there. So this is what there in the input. Why it is given as input counter? You can have more than one input. For example, you have two transactions of 55 Bitcoin, and you have to make 10 Bitcoin, that is BTC, to some other person. So you don't have any BTC with 10. So what you will do is you will take this 255 transaction, that this is one transaction and another transaction you will be having. Like here you can see index 0 and index 1. Then you can pay to the next person. So that's why you can have more than one input and you can have more than one output also. Here in this case you can have. So why we are having more than one output? As I already said, if you are having 10 BTC, but you have to pay only 5 BTC to someone, in that case, how will you pay? You have to pay 10 because you cannot change it. So you have to pay as a transaction, in that one output will contain 5 BTC to the receiver and another 5 BTC for your own account. So that's why you should have more than one transaction. There are cases you will have 3 transaction, also 4 transaction, and some cases there will be only one transaction. And when it comes into the output transaction, you can see the value, how much to be paid, and again the transcript out length, because here also when you are validating something here for this transaction, the same thing has to be, similarly the output transaction should also be validated, because we have to pay to someone, right? We have to ensure whether that respective address is available or not. So that will be done in this. So next is, you can see the witness. What is this witness is? It is also introduced late in the Bitcoin. It is not from the inception. So what they want to do is, if we are going to keep the signature or public key in the transaction, then what happened, the transaction size will be more, and every block can contain, the maximum size is defined for every block. And if you are going to keep the public key and the signature, definitely the size of single transaction will be more. Because of that, you cannot include more transactions. And people want to add more transactions so that the transactions will get confirmed as early as possible. So in that case, what they have done is, they have introduced the concept of witness. Here they move the witness, that is the signature and all, to this place. If you are having 10, let's say, output transactions or the input transaction, those witnesses will be moved to the witness part, that is the public key and all will be moved to the witness part, and this witness portion will not be counted as for the size of the that is the maximum size of the block. So what happens, since you are saving that space, that can be included for more transaction. So that is the advantage. Next is the lock time. So we have fixed deposit when we go for a bank. So similarly here, what they will do is, they will say that this transaction cannot be spent for next some number of blocks. So up to that number of blocks, this particular transaction cannot be spent. So like you are having the fixed deposit for a period of time. So if the flag is 1, that means lock time is there. If the flag is 0, that means there is no lock time for the transaction. So that is the use of the flag. But in future, they may add some other things. So this is what the Bitcoin transaction is. And there are transactions which are based on some other transaction, but there are transaction which is called as the coin-based transaction. What this means is, as I was telling, that there is a reward. For the reward, there is no beginning, okay? That is no preceding transactions. If I am mining a block, I am generating the reward for myself. So those transactions are called as the coin-based transaction. Okay, so that means a transaction which does not have any parent transaction is referred as coin-based. You can see for this transaction, this is the parent transaction. Similarly, for this transaction, there will be some other transactions as the parent transaction. But this coin-based transaction does not have any parent. So if there is no parent, then what will be there in the previous transaction hash? That will be some random value, for example, in the Genesis block. Because if you see the blocks, this has the hash value of this as per this one. So what is the previous hash of this is? This one. So similarly this. What about the Genesis block? Because that is the very first block that does not have any preceding hash. So for that, what they have written is, they have written something like this, times 3rd gen 2009, Chancellor of Brink something they have written, because this might be the time the Bitcoin was started. So like this, some random value is written. Similarly, for coin-based transaction, the previous, that is the preceding hash transaction, will be something random. And every block should have this coin-based transaction. It is mandatory. And because of this transaction only, the transaction fee and reward will be computed. And one more thing, you know that when the Bitcoin was started, in the Genesis block, the Bitcoin does not have any money. That is, no Bitcoin was available. So when the first block comes, that means 15, that time it was 50 Bitcoin was generated since somebody has mined. So next 50, this is, it is not always 50, it is reducing, that I will be talking in future slides. So like that, new coins are produced, and the maximum limit is 21 million BTC. After that, we don't have any reward. So this is what the coin-based transaction is. And next, when we talk about the transaction, sometimes what happens, the age of the transaction will be computed. So let's say I make a transaction and there is a, we can say that transaction fee for every transaction. If I give more transaction fee, the miner will be very much happy to choose my transaction. The reason is, there are n number of transactions sent by m number of people, and this all goes to the unspent transaction output. And what happened, it will not go to unspent transaction output, it will be going to the transaction pool, which will be taken for mining. And in that, miner has to choose some of the transaction to include in his first block or second block, like that. So based on what he will choose the transaction, definitely he will choose the transaction which pay more transaction fee. And let's assume that I make a transaction and I don't have sufficient money with my account, so I give very less transaction fee. Then what happens is, no miner will take my transaction. If no miner takes my transaction, then even if it is 10 years also, whatever transaction I have done will be kept as it is, and it is not committed into the blockchain. So I have not paid anything, just I am holding that money. So this is the drawback of the system. So how they have improved this is, they compute the transaction age. So you can see here, there are so many transactions, right? Transaction 0, 1, 2, 3, and like this, there will be n number of transactions. So what the improvement they have given is, the very first transaction of any block, that will be coin-based transaction. Okay, no other transaction. By default, coin-based transaction will be the very first transaction. That means TX0 will be the coin-based transaction. After that, there are some transactions we should keep. Those are the one allotted to the transactions which are living for some long time. Okay, so that's where the transaction age comes. If the age of a transaction is something, then that should be taken into the block. Otherwise, that will not be accepted. So what this means is, the number of transactions in a block are categorized into three. Okay, the first is coin-based transaction, that is mandatory. The second set of blocks, that is based on age. And the third set of blocks, that is based on the transaction fee and all. So what happens in the age-based transactions, the miners does not have chance to choose some transaction where the reward will be, or the transaction fee will be more. He has to see the age of the transaction. If some age is, if some transaction's age is more, then miner has to pick that transaction and use it. And now the next thing is, why this problem comes? Why they are not able to pay the transaction fee? Or when some transaction is considered as, we should not take, since there is no transaction fee. So there are two types of transaction, which is unprofitable, and another one is the dust transaction. So in case of unprofitable transaction, let's say I am going to make a transaction for 0.0001 BTC, or we can say for one Satoshi I am going to do. One Satoshi is equal to, or we can say 100 crore Satoshi is equal to one BTC. Okay, but I am going to make one Satoshi as a transaction. If I make one Satoshi as a transaction and the transaction fee, let's say, as 2 Satoshi, then will there be any benefit for the miner? And also assume that the respective sender is not having that money in his account. So definitely miner cannot take from any of his account, that means sender's account. So that becomes unprofitable. So they will not take it for mining. And next is the dust transaction. What is this dust transaction means? That this is also unprofitable, but here only difference is I make a transaction and the balance or the reward, the transaction fee is 3 times more than what the transaction I am making. Okay, so those transactions are called as the dust transaction. So both are same. The only difference is how much the transaction fee is payable and how much the respective sender is having in his account. So if these are the two transactions, definitely no miner will take. And if no miner takes, the transaction will never be confirmed. So because of the transaction age feature, these transactions will also be included in the blockchain. So that is the use of transaction age in Bitcoin. So very, very important notes. The first thing is the target I was talking about. The target varies for every 2 weeks. It is not constant. I said that, right? They have to generate some hash value. It should be less than the target. And the target is adjusted for every 2 weeks. And the maximum BTC available is 21 million, not more than that. And the header size of each block is 80 bytes. And one block can have maximum 1 MB of data, that is including the transaction. So you remember I was telling in the transaction, they are moving the signature part and all to the witnesses so that they can include more transaction. That is because of this. You cannot have more than 1 MB of block size, which includes header as well as the data part. And next is the confirmation. I have written here 7 blocks, but actually it is 6 or more. What is this confirmation is, you remember in this place I was telling, if I have mined this block or this block, till the next 6 blocks are made, it is not confirmed that this particular block will be part of the main chain. And again, I repeat, there is no mathematical proof. It's based on the practical experience they have given that. So why this one is focused? Let's say I made a transaction and also I mined the block, and that block contains this transaction. And I send to the next person this block, and that block contains the transaction, and that respective person, maybe the receiver of the transaction, sends the product to me, equivalent product to me. So I received the product, I enjoy. Okay, maybe after 4, 5, 6 block, there is a possibility the block which I have mined and sent to that person is not part of the main chain. Then what will happen? Whatever transaction I made is not there. If the transaction what I made is not there means, then whatever the product he has sent to me will be loss for that the person, okay, the sender. So that's why we should not act on the transaction immediately until unless at least next 6 blocks are made on top of the block on which your transaction is committed. Next is the transaction reward, that is the transaction fee. Every transaction is having the transaction fee, but there are transactions like, as I was telling, the unprofitable and dust transaction doesn't have the reward. And next is the reward hops. This is the mining reward gets halved every year. Okay, you can see this. It was first started with 50 BTC. That means for every mining of block, they get 50 Bitcoin. And after that, it becomes 25, then 12.5. And in 2020, actually, this image is not clear. You can refer this particular URL. In 2020, it is changed to 6.25. So now if anybody mines a block, they will get the reward of 625. Then it will be coming to 3 point something. At one point of time, it will be zero. So when it will be zero, nobody will show interest in mining the block. So how the Bitcoin is going to survive? So what they are saying is the transaction fee is there, right? So this is coming down, the transaction will be going up. So automatically they will be getting motivated to mine the block. And for confirmation, I was telling that at least 6 blocks we have to wait. Now you can see in Bitcoin, the average time of each block mining is 10 minutes. Okay. So now what happens is the probability of block being found, that is the probability of block being part of main chain. Okay. Consider that. If you see up to 10 minutes, that means up to one block, the maximum chance is it's less than 50%, or we can say less than around 55% only chance is there up to 10 minutes. But if you are going for 20 minutes, then the chance is up to 80%. And you see here, when we come into 60%, that is the 60 minutes waiting time, you can see the percentage or the probability that the block being part of the main chain. So what happens is this 60 minutes means 6 blocks. After that, we can guarantee that the block can be definitely part of the main chain. Till that time, don't take any action. So so what happens if you are going to apply the Bitcoin concept into any other application, let's assume, and I make a transaction on which I say, yes, so and so is the attacker, and I send the transaction. But you see, according to this time, the transaction will be really accepted by people after 60 minutes. After 60 minutes, if some people are going to say, yes, that he is the attacker, we can consider that. What about this time? Okay, in this time, this attacker might have done a lot of things. Okay, 1 hour is huge for them. So what will happen? Okay, so when you are going to some other application, then such kind of problems will be there. And these are like research problems, how we are going to solve it. Okay, so if any questions, please let me know up to this.
Sir, is it the same case with Ethereum?
That 60 minutes?
Yes.
So in Ethereum, it is maximum 23 seconds like that. Just 1 second, I will show you.
Okay.
Are you able to see this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is almost live mining is going on, the live statistics of Ethereum. You can see the time of last block. Okay. You see this place.
Hello.
Yes. Just I will let you know. See, 28 seconds. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
So in 28 seconds, one block is mined. According to them, the block is getting mined in 15 minutes. Okay, 15 seconds. For every 15 seconds, there is a block mined. But they have the concept of difficulty bomb. Okay, when there will be a difficulty bomb, then it takes a lot of time. Okay, that is not so easy. It is like if you have if the number of blocks are something more than lakh or 10 lakhs, then they implement the difficulty bomb. Why they implement is they want to go for the fork. They want to update the software. Okay, in that time, they go for it. If there is very less time, they cannot make the update. That's the reason.
Okay, sir.
So, in case of Bitcoin, it is 10 minutes for block, but in case of Ethereum, it is 15 seconds they consider. And here, if it is 6 blocks, that is 60 minutes, there it is 23 blocks. Up to 23 blocks, we should not make or act on the transaction, whichever is put. We have to wait for that time. Okay, so that's the only difference.
Okay, sir.
Any other questions?
No, sir.
Okay. So the next is very important thing, that is the puzzle solving. So I was talking about the distributed, the consensus, that is in distributed system, how we will ensure the agreement. Okay, that how we will come to the agreement. Okay, for that, I was talking about the Byzantine solutions and all. There are two types of failures, as I said, one is crash failure and another one is Byzantine failure. In case of crash failure, those are not an attack. It's the actual hardware failure, or we can say power failure like that. And that will be applied mainly to the permissioned blockchain. So there are algorithms like Raft and all available. Okay. And another one is Byzantine. Again, in Byzantine, if we know the people and they perform the attack, so then in that case, we will go for the Byzantine fault tolerance. In these two, that is the Raft protocol and Byzantine fault tolerance, these things are the deterministic one. That means once I mine the block, definitely that block will be part of the chain. But there are consensus protocols. Those will not be deterministic. Those are probabilistic. That means the block, whatever is mined, may be part of the chain or may not be part of the chain, as we have seen in this place. So you can see here, it takes part or it does not take part. So those types of consensus algorithms are called as the probabilistic consensus algorithms, and the proof of work, which is used in Bitcoin as well as in Ethereum. The implementation is different, but they call it as proof of work. This is the probabilistic consensus algorithm. So that means we cannot make sure that the block mined by me will be definitely part of the chain or not. So how this proof of work works? Before that, let me give a brief introduction about this proof of work. So this was introduced by Cynthia Dwork, I think in 1991 they have introduced. So why they have introduced this is mainly to stop the spam emails. So if I have to spend some email to anybody, I can just like that send it. But right now we have Google, that is intelligent. Not even Gmail, Yahoo and all, those are intelligent, that automatically puts some of the mails into spam. But you know, that time there was nothing like that. And people can send massive number of emails. When sender is sending massive number of emails, which are useless, and the receiver has to spend time on it, and they have to see whether the mail is required or not. So they have introduced the proof of work concept. What they have done is, before the sender sends the email, they have to do some work. It's like they have to solve the puzzle and then they have to send the email to the receiver. Once the receiver receives the email, they will see whether the puzzle is solved or not, because solving the puzzle takes massive attempt to verify whether the problem is solved or not. That is one-time attempt required. They will see if it is okay, then they will accept that mail as actual mail. Otherwise, they will send it to spam. So like this, the proof of work helps in stopping the spammers. So the similar concept with some modification they have applied into the Bitcoin as well as in the cryptocurrency applications. So here they in Bitcoin they use Hashcash based proof of work. That is the one mostly all of them uses. And with that, they make sure that people cannot send the block just like that. That means they have to solve a puzzle and then they have to send it. So what is the puzzle here is, again, consider the SHA-256 hash function. You give some input and it has to produce an output. And that output should be less than the target. Okay, so you can see here, this is the output what you are going to produce, and that should be less than this. So it should not be more than 2 power 256 because the output, the maximum output is 2 power 256 minus 1 and divided by the HD. What is this HD? I will let you know. This is the difficulty. Okay, so that means this is the target. Okay, the output of the hash function should be less than this, less than or equal to this target. Otherwise, it will not be allowed. So this is what the problem is. I will come to this all little later. So are you able to visualize this hash one? That means there is a hash function, that is SHA hash function available. We have to give some input, and that particular function produces output. The function is deterministic function, but it produces some output. Why it is deterministic is whatever number of times you are going to give the same input, that function is going to produce the same output. That output space is from 0 to 2 power 256 minus 1. It can produce any value between this range. Okay, that is its space. So now what is the requirement here is the miner has to find out some input which will be given to the hash function, and it produces the output, and that output should be less than this target. So that is what mandatory in this place. So are you able to understand this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So people may think that it is so easy to generate or solve the puzzle. So let me tell my implementation. What I have done is, in my normal machine, I did the same computation. It's not for Bitcoin, just for testing I have done. As I said, the maximum target is 2 power 256. It is not more than that. Okay. So let me say that if you the maximum space is 10, that means from 1 to 10 is the maximum space. It cannot produce output more than 10. And I am asking the user to find out the input which will produce output less than 10. So less than or equal to 10, then what happens? Whatever input he is going to choose, that will definitely produce some output which will be less than or equal to 10. Then what I will do is I will put the condition, make it the input produce the out the by giving the input, let the function produce the output less than 2. Then what happens? He has to do lot of attempts because 1 to 10 is the initial target. That is the range. But now I am saying instead of 1 to 10, that will be there as 1 to 10. But I want that you produce between 1 and 2 only. That is 1 and 2 should be the output. It should not be 3, 4, 5 up to 10. So then what happens? I have to do more attempts. So similarly, what I have done is, initially I fixed the target as 2 power 250. And the input is something, one portion of the input is fixed, and the second part I have given as the random number. So it is not the random number, it is the sequence number. So first part of the input concatenated with sequence number 1. And it is given to the hash function, it produces some output. And then that output is verified whether it is less than the target or not. If it is not less than the target, then what I have done is, again, I fixed the first part of the input same. And instead of 1, I applied 2. Then I applied 3, 4, 5. And there is no point in applying the same value again and again because the algorithm is deterministic. Every time you will get the same output. So this 1, 2, 3 I am talking about, right? These are called as nonce. You remember that in the block header, we keep the nonce. Okay, so let's say with the input and the number 10, I identified, that is the second part of the input, number 10, I identified the hash output, which is less than 2 power 250. So now what happens is, now this 10 becomes the nonce and the 2 power 250 is the target. Okay, these things will be there in the block. When it goes to the next person who is going to validate, what he will do is, he will take the first part of the input, which is there in the block, and he will take the nonce, he will concatenate, and then he will generate the output, and he can find out that is less than the target. So that means in one attempt itself, somebody can be verified. But to identify or to bring that nonce, they have to make lot of attempts. Okay, so I have fixed, so I was writing based on the parallel processing. I wrote the thread with four, the machine was having four cores, so I was running four process. And the target I have fixed is this. And as I said, then you some fixed the input, first part of input, second is sequentially I was increasing. So what I find is, in 0.295 seconds, don't refer to this, let's consider only this, 0.295 seconds, with these many number of attempts, I found the input or the nonce which gives the hash output less than this. So when I bring the target into 2 power 240, I was repeating the same process, and it takes 2 power 89 seconds. So here you can see for the, and the number of attempts are these many. And you may see that here it takes 0.295 seconds, but here it is 0.289 seconds. Don't think in that perspective. You can see here it is more. And also I was running four parallel process. Okay, so because of that, if you go through this real time and user time of Linux, you will get more idea about it. So then I fixed the target as 2 power 230. Then it took 15 seconds and these many attempts were required. And when I put 2 power 220 as my target and this much time was required and these many attempts were made. And when I fix the target as 2 power 210, even after this time, I was not able to find the answer. That is, I'm not able to solve the puzzle. So what you can understand is, it is not so easy to solve the puzzle. And also the target they will fix, the maximum target in there is 2 power 224. Okay, so if it is 2 power 224, then it can be solved with this time. And that too by the normal machine. When you are, and you see how much time it is required. And you know, in our case, within 10 minutes, the block has to be mined. Okay, if the block is not mined in 10 minutes, some others will mine. And if the target will be this, I never mine the block. Okay, with the normal machine, we cannot mine the block. So then what will happen? Okay, so that is the reason, if you see the Bitcoin miners, they invest lot of, we can say, lot of infrastructure to do that mining. So you remember in the beginning itself, I was telling that provided some infrastructure, that is the maximum infrastructure is with the attacker. So what this means is, in the blockchain application, we are saying it is impossible or virtually impossible to modify the existing block or the transaction. So provided that 51% of this hash computing power, that is the complete networks, 51% of the hash computing power is not with the attacker. So in that case only, it is possible that attacker cannot modify the data. Otherwise, they can modify the data. But you know, it's not so easy to have that 51%, because if you consider a single attacker or a set of attacker, that has to be compared with the rest of the world. So it's not so easy. If the number of miners are less, then we can say, but there are so many miners, and why there are so many? Because of money involved. Okay, so it is not very easy to get 51% of the hash computing power with the attack.
Sir.
So, yes, please.
Sir, on what basis these targets have been revised?
I will come to that. There is an equation for it.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So in this case, if you see, everybody is going trying to solve this puzzle. If everybody is trying to solve the puzzle, definitely only one is going to get the reward or the transaction. So if everybody is trying, and you can see how much computational power is required for this, you can see there are so many websites, you can find out how much carbon dioxide they are emitting and other things are given, how much electricity is consumed. So these all are going waste. So they come up with some other idea, which is called proof of stake. The puzzle solving is same, but here it restricts the user. Instead of allowing any miners to solve the problem puzzle, they say that the users, the participants, whoever is having more stake in the network, that means who is having more money or who is having money for long time, only those people are chosen for mining. Others are not allowed to do mine. But the problem with this is the one who is having more money, further they will get more money. And the one who is not are having less money, they will always be having less money. And next is the proof of burn. This is also the consensus protocol, but this is mainly for changing the coin from one to another. Let's say now we have Bitcoin. After some time, they want to start the, they want to destroy the Bitcoin and they want to have some other coin. So how can they do it? So what they do is they allow the person to burn the coin. Okay. So if he burns the coin here, that means he put the coin in some address, and for that address, nobody is having the private key. Okay. This is what called as the burning. So if some miner burns, then he will get the preference in the next cryptocurrency to do mining. So in that way, whatever he burned there in one coin, he will get in the another coin. Next is the proof of elapsed time. This, I think, Intel itself gives in their processor. Once you do mining, you cannot do mining next for some period of time. After that, only you will be allowed. So that is designed in the chip itself. It is designed in the hardware so that the consumption will, the energy consumption will be low. So how the target is fixed? So the initial target, that is very first target they have fixed, is 2 power 224, or we can say the maximum target is 2 power 24, but it is represented in the format. There is a format they follow, accordingly that number is represented. So now what is the criteria? So they have fixed that for every 10 minutes one block has to be mined. So for 2 weeks, if you see, total 2016 blocks has to be mined. In case only 1000 block is mined in that period of time, then what will happen is the target will be relaxed. That means the difficulty will be low. If we say that 2016 block has to be mined in 2 weeks, but they have mined 3000 blocks in that 2 weeks, then what they will do is the target they have relaxed, right? They will bring it down. That means the difficulty will be more. So automatically what happens is the mining will be adjusted. So you can see here, first let's take the deviation, which is given as expected time and the actual time. So what is this expected time is, in 2 weeks, they need 2016 blocks. That means 2 weeks means how much time it required, we have to fill this. And actual time it has taken, maybe 2016 blocks mined in 1 week or in 3 weeks, that will be applied. So that will be the deviation. The deviation will be multiplied with the previous, or we can say the ongoing. For example, I want to fix the target for this particular 2 weeks. So what the world difficulty means? The world difficulty is the last 2 weeks difficulty. Okay. So the deviation will be multiplied with the old difficulty. So that becomes the current difficulty. So using the current difficulty, the maximum target is fixed. The target is maximum target by the difficulty. That is what the current target fixed for the next 2 weeks. So that means if the blocks are mined, or very less number of blocks are mined, then there will be more number of, then the target will be relaxed. That means the difficulty will be less. In case less number of blocks mined, then the difficulty will be high. So in this way, the difficulty is adjusted. That means every 2 weeks, the difficulty get adjusted. But in case of Ethereum, for every block, they adjust the difficulty. And one more very important thing, when we are adjusting the difficulty, we have to make sure the deviation should not be more than this. Okay, maximum 4 times. And here also it is like that. You cannot jump to the target or the difficulty very less or very high. So what happens in both the cases, this will be like an extreme and it may sabotage the system. So that's why they put this condition also. Even if it goes more than this, then also you have to fix that as the maximum value, not more than that. So are you getting? In this way only the Bitcoin difficulty is fixed. If you have any doubt, then please let me know.
Okay, sir.
Any doubt?
No, sir. As of now, no.
Okay. So I will proceed. But this one has the centralization problem. What is the centralization problem is, if we all are mining and you assume that most of the time I am winning, then what happens? You people will get discouraged. Once you get discouraged, you will not be taking part in mining and you will be acting as a normal node. So in that case, what happened? I will be leading the chain. So this becomes the centralization problem. So there is no solution for this particular Bitcoin, but in Ethereum they are solving this by giving the reward to the blocks which are not part of the main chain. So in that way they encourage, but in Bitcoin it is not like that. And another advantage how the centralization problem solved is because of the equivalency, that is the exchange rate. More people are going towards mining. So what happens is automatically the number of miners get increased and that centralization problem is getting solved. And the attacks, if you see, if you take any distributed system, there is a possibility of cyber attack. That means one user will have, that means with the same hardware, they will post multiple identities. So what will happen is, for example, I say that let's say that we are going for e-voting based on the hardware, and maybe one device with the same hardware will give 5 votes. Okay, so that means one person with defined infrastructure, he will give multiple identities or he will showcase multiple identities. So this is what is the cyber attack. But how the Bitcoin or the proof of work solves it, if you see, the puzzle to be solved is huge. If I am the single person and I am saying I am 10%, even then I am showing as 10%. If I apply mining, if I am trying parallelly for all 10 users with my existing infrastructure, I will not definitely win the race. So when I can win the race, if I am mining for only one user, then there is a chance that I will win the race. So that's why automatically the cyber attack here is gone. They can perform the cyber attack, but attackers are not going to gain anything out of it. And this will not affect the network also. And the double spending, that a coin can be spent more than once.
Can you please explain again that cyber attack?
So what the cyber attack is, there is a person with some infrastructure, okay, and that with that infrastructure he can prove one of his identity. But what he will do is he will try to have n number of identity. Allowed identity is one, but he is saying I am A, I am B, I am C. That the same person with the same infrastructure showing to the outside world with different identities. so that he will get something. That means here what they can do is, if I am the single person, I can work as a single miner. But if I show as 10 person, then I can work as a 10 miner. So how the proof of work stops this is, they have to solve the huge puzzle. And for that huge puzzle, I need massive infrastructure. And if I am having massive infrastructure, but I am dividing it for n number of users, that for multiple identities, then what happened, that will be very, very less when compared to other actual user who is having the same infrastructure. So definitely that guy will win the race. And the one who is showing, or I am the one showing with multiple identities, I cannot mine the block and I succeed in the race.
Yes, sir, got it. Because that node has to do so many computations with 10 different identity, and that is
the chances
of getting its node block mined will be less compared to other users. Got it. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So next is the double spending. You know that in double spending, this coin will be spent more than once. So how Bitcoin stops is, one is we say for the next 6 blocks, don't react on the transaction. And the second thing, because of the proof of work, there is no user going to take over the control of the network. That means centralization is not possible. However, if the number of miners are less, then there is a possibility of centralization. But again, they control the centralization, or they mitigate the centralization problem by one is this exchange rate, and also developer contact some of the miners and encourage them to do the mining. Also, you know that developers are all, will also be part of mining, so that it will not become the centralization. So in that way, double spending is overcome. Next is the Eclipse attack. I will come to that. Is this one visible? That slide number 6?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is visible. It is visible, sir.
So now what is the Eclipse attack? So we see, right, solar eclipse, and we see the solar eclipse, right? And solar lunar eclipse. So here what happens is, let's say this is the person connected into the network and he has the neighbor. Okay, let's say these two are the neighbor. And if these two neighbors are colluded with each other and they are compromised, then what happens is they form the eclipse here. If this particular user make any transaction and want to put to the network, he or she has only chance to send to these two guys. When this particular person sends to these two guys, they are already compromised. They made the eclipse. They won't forward it further. Either the block or the transaction. If they don't forward further, it will be like this guy is isolated. Even though he is connected, he is getting isolated. So what the solution they give is, I have not gone through in Bitcoin, in Ethereum, what solution they are giving is, they say that you are going to have this, some of the neighbors, right? This particular node will be having the neighbors. That neighbors list should have the developer identity also. There will be developer, they normally don't do any malicious activity, so you keep them also as a neighbor. And the second thing, they are asking to apply this Kademlia network. In that network, what they say is, don't allow, that is for maintaining the neighbors, don't allow any of the users who sends the request to be part of the neighbors list. See what happens once I take part in this network. You might have seen that once you have got the phone number, you will get so many phone calls and asking to join here and there. Okay, so they suggest that if somebody is coming like that, don't consider that only they are the neighbors and you broadcast to them only. So in that case, there is a possibility of Eclipse attack. So what you do is, one is you include the developer also in your neighbors list. So if you send to them, they will not definitely do the Eclipse attack. Second, not only consider the person who sends the request, if you also know somebody through some other communication, then you put them also into the neighbors list. So what happens is automatically you will be having the diverse set of neighbors. Because of that, there is no Eclipse attack possible. So I hope this one is clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Can I ask one simple question?
Yes, yes, please.
Sir, it was regarding that 6 PPT itself. While discussing it first time, you have said that normally when it was a matter of forwarding this particular block and all, so you have said that like the neighbor, if he is not interested to forward because he is not getting any particular reward for that thing, na? So for them, he has to simply work as a messenger only. Na? In that case, you have said that later on we will just discuss. So please, sir, can you put some light on that matter?
No, I will come. It's not yet over.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Fine. Okay.
That Payal will answer, I think, mostly.
Yeah. Yes.
Sir, everyone wants you to answer that question first and then proceed.
Yes.
Okay. I will come to that.
Okay.
See, we'll only 2 more slides are there. Okay. After that, I will come to that.
Yes.
Okay sir.
So, Eclipse attack is clear, and this one I have shown to you all already, okay, but you might have not seen it completely, but the slides will be shared. Please go through this, you will get lot of idea. Okay, and another one is this bit info charts. Is this visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Bit info. You can see how many bit crypto currencies are there. There are so many cryptocurrencies. Okay. And you can see the each cryptocurrency, its equivalent rate and other things. Let's come to the block. See, you can see the block time. It may be the last block which takes 9 minutes to mine, and here in Ethereum, it is 13.1 second. And block count, you see, in Bitcoin, I think it is 6,53,000, right? But if you see in this, how many blocks are mined till now? It's very simple. You can see in last 24 hours, here it is 146, and here it is 6,558 blocks are mined. And here also, there is a reward. And if the equivalency of BTC with INR is similar to ETH, then what will happen? There will be too much money available with ETH, that is the Ethereum. So why I am showing this is, if you are doing some research on some other topics using blockchain, that time this particular data may help you in giving some that justification. So what we have done a work where we use this blockchain for e healthcare. Okay, so that time, because the block has to keep on grow and there are so many minings required, that puzzle solving required. So in that case, how we will justify that this blockchain can be used for e-health application. So I took some of the data from here and I claimed that yes, we can use, and this is not very high, it is manageable. Okay, so similarly, you can also see to this. This will help you a lot. So that's why I want to show this one to you all. And here you can see the complete, this is only on Ethereum, even though it's not my topic. So I thought of mainly to show this part. And you can see the miners, whoever is mining, their details. And you can see from which location the mining is happening. And you can see in India, there is no mining. Okay, but sometimes you may find mining happens in this particular part, that's in our country. So the next important thing between the Bitcoin and Ethereum, I have one more slide, then it's over. Then we will go to that discussion. So both are cryptocurrency. There are decentralized application can be built on Ethereum, but in Bitcoin, it's not possible because here the smart contract is there, but in case of Bitcoin, there is no smart contract. And Bitcoin works based on transaction, that is UTXO. But in case of Ethereum, it works based on balance. The consensus both uses the proof of work, and both the consensus algorithms are probabilistic. And the average confirm, that is the block mining time, here it's 10 minutes and here it is 15 seconds. And in both, fork is possible because of the probabilistic. And the confirmation time or waiting time, we can say it is not 7 blocks. 7 blocks is also okay, but 6 or more blocks required at least. Then 23 blocks in case of Ethereum. And both are decentralized and there is no authority. And both are permissionless. That means when any user want to join, no need to ask anybody. But you should have some money. That is either Ethereum, Ether you have to have, or you have to, you should keep Bitcoin. Then only you can change. And the world state I was talking about in the very beginning. In Bitcoin, there is no world state, but in Ethereum, there is a world state to pick the data from the latest block itself. And there are two types of blockchain. One is permissionless and permissioned blockchain. In case of permissionless, it is completely public. Anybody can take part in the network and perform read and write operation. So what is this read and write operation is? Read operation means just they can read it. But in case of write operation, they can put the transactions. Okay, that one is they can read what the transaction is and validate. And another one is they can create the transaction and put it, including creating the mining the blocks. So again, that there is one public permission and private permission. See, this one is required when you go for research oriented. Okay, otherwise, this is not that much required. So public permission and private permission, you can see the permission means only the authorized users are allowed to take part in the blockchain. And what is this public and private is, in that authorized set of users, anybody is allowed to read and write. But in case of here, there are only restricted users are allowed to write, remaining are allowed to read. Okay, so they do like this. So when you will decide which blockchain to be used for your application, if you want to store the state, that means the status, if you want to store, then you go for this, otherwise don't choose blockchain. And if you are having more than one writers, that is multiple writers, then you go for blockchain, otherwise don't go for blockchain. And if you use trusted third party, then don't go for blockchain again. And if there is no trusted, that is online trusted third party, then you think of blockchain. And if you know all writers, then you should think of permissioned. If you don't know any of the writers, then go for permissionless. That is what the public blockchains, we can say Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many others, including IOTA. And if you are saying that you know the writers, and if you know all the writers and you are trusting them, then no need of blockchain. Otherwise, you see, is public verifiability required? So you have the writers, and if whether you want to allow public to verify your transactions, that whatever is written, if so, then go for public permissioned blockchain. Otherwise, go for private permissioned blockchain. So when you are going to choose blockchain for your application, please think in this perspective and then take the decision what type of blockchain you have to use. First, you have to decide who are the players. That is very important. So if any questions, then please let me know. I almost completed.
Except sir, can this. You please go at the last slide, that blockchain classification?
Yes, please.
Sir, in that slide, you wrote that all the nodes or all the users are trusted, but is public verifiability is required or not? So if all the writers are trusted and public verifiability...
See, are all writers trusted? If yes, then no need of blockchain.
Okay. Yes.
If no, then only you have to go.
Yes, sir. Okay. Can you give some use cases which falls under particular classification? Say, for example,
we are using for healthcare, okay? So in that, we go for this public permissioned blockchain, okay? And see, even in healthcare itself, we can say in some places we can go for private. But in our application, we say that we, in our paper, we have not mentioned whether we are going for public or private permission blockchain. We mentioned that we will be going for permissioned blockchain. The reason is the hospitals are known. Okay, they are already known, and we are including the insurance agency also to take part. And obviously, government organization will also be there. So all these are already known. And even the patients whom we are going to consider, they are also known. Okay, so in case of permissionless, we consider the dynamic network, especially for the smart transportation system. What we do is we consider that we don't know anything about the person in beforehand. And then we want to authenticate them. So for that case, we use the permissionless blockchain.
Hmm. Okay. Yes, sir.
Even if you are going for supply chain management and all, then you will be going for permission. Even this land record management system, that also uses the permissioned blockchain. So there you can say this will be the right option because any public can verify that.
Yes, sir. Sir, got it. Thank you. Yes, do we have any other questions from participants?
No, madam.
No file. Thank you.
Okay. So now let me go for that question.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now let's say that this particular person makes a transaction and send to these guys. So if this particular person is making a transaction, he is going to take, he is going to get some advantage. And these guys are just going to forward. If they are going to forward, if they will simply forward and they don't get any advantage, so because the sender is going to have something, that is the owner of the transaction, and just by forwarding, they are not going to get anything. So why should they forward? The first thing is to mine the block, the transactions to be there. And let's say this guy is going to mine a block, and that includes the transaction of this person. Then in such case, if he is not going to forward that particular transaction here, then how this person will validate the block which includes the transaction of this guy? See, please try to understand this. He makes a transaction and sent to him, and this guy does not want to forward since he is not going to take the advantage, but he is going to mine the block. When he is mining the block, he is going to consider his transaction also. That means this particular guy's transaction is part of the block mined by this guy. And then he forward the block to this guy and this guy. That is the mined block to all these three guys. Now all these three guys have to verify the block, validate the block. So what the validation includes? It includes the validation of the transaction. So the block contains the transaction of this guy. If the miner, this particular node is going to validate the transaction, that means his transaction, but the transaction is not there with him. The transaction is there as a part of block he sent, but not the transaction whatever he sent. So in that case, his block will not be validated here. So he has only chance, if he want to successfully get the block validated, he has to forward the block transactions. Otherwise, it is not possible. It is not going to give advantage to the block, whatever he is going to mine. So that's why all of them will forward the transaction.
So it's a win-win situation for all the nodes. In that scenario, only that they have to just that thing. Yes. Thank you very much.
So this is for transaction. Next for block, why somebody has to forward the block? If this person mined the block, he is going to get the reward, then why these guys has to forward? So why they have to forward is, if this person mined the block and give it to this place, and this person is also miner, what he will do, definitely he will not mine the block which is already mined by him. He will mine the next block. When he is mining the next block, he will consider the base block as the block mined by this guy. So then let's say he successfully mined the block and forward to the next neighbors. When he is forwarding to the neighbors will see the parent block hash, but the parent block is not forwarded by him. If the parent block is not forwarded by him, then his block will also be not considered and it will not be validated, it will be discarded. So because of these reasons, they will forward the transaction as well as they will forward the blocks.
Are but you getting sir, you say that one should not react immediately for or upon any transaction. Mm-hmm. They should wait for their block to get confirmed, the, to be part of the network. So yes. If I am the second miner, somebody else has sent me a block.
Why I said that is, see, I make a transaction to you, okay?
Okay.
And if you are going to make one more transaction on based on this transaction, then only that one is applicable.
Hmm. Okay.
Otherwise, yes. It is not applicable. See, if I make a transaction to you and you are going to make a transaction based on this transaction, so what happens is, without knowing whether the transaction I sent to you is part of the main chain or not, you are making another transaction. Here it is not making another transaction. Here you are forwarding the transaction. But one thing is, here they are making another block. So this person creates one block and he is considering that block as the base block and he is creating the another block. So in that case, no need to wait for next 7 blocks, because if the next 7 blocks are going to be mined very quick when based on the this particular block of this guy, then only that will take part of the main chain. Otherwise, it will not take part in the main chain. So that one is different and this one is completely different.
Sir, what if I don't have any transaction to make right now? Will I forward your transaction to other nodes or not?
See, if you don't have any transaction and also you don't want to mine any block, okay? Mm. So then you don't need to forward. You will not forward. Okay, but there is no problem.
How in that case, sir, like that first miner has to just keep that node, na? That will not maintain the continuity.
Minimum, you will be having 7 neighbors. That is the minimum.
Okay.
If one miner goes, there is no problem.
Yes.
Sorry, one neighbor goes, there is no issue.
Okay.
Yes, so got it.
So any other doubts?
Yes, any participant? Do you have any particular question?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Sir, on
so
behalf
I
of...
I have a question.
Okay.
Just a minute.
Sorry, ma'am.
Sir, I have a very, very simple and a layperson's question.
Yes,
where do you think this whole, cryptocurrency scene is going to move towards in the near future? Do we see more of the countries adopting it, or is it going to die down, or how does this
work? See, that,
so what do you think is the future?
The chance of dying is very, very less because people have invested a lot.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And also it is not on the hand of a single person or set of users. Okay, it includes massive. Let's say in India, we stop using cryptocurrency. Okay, but
okay.
Other countries will use it. Okay, it's completely like distributed.
Okay.
Okay, one thing will happen, the rate will come down. That exchange rate is there, right? That may come down.
Okay.
Okay, and it is spread like anything now.
And the country is also legally adopting it, I believe, right?
Yes.
So there is a future to this cryptocurrency. We should look at it more seriously than what we are just passing, like from a management perspective in finance, like your college has already started to train professionals, train students, but many have not caught on the bandwagon. I think it should be seriously taken.
Again.
Actually, see, again, I say most of them, they consider blockchain and they do study on the Bitcoin. That is, they analyze the rate, how it is growing and all. This management guys does this. Mm-hmm. But they are also planning to use blockchain for supply chain management and the other concepts. Even in fintech, they use this blockchain concept.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you for the answer.
Sir, there is one more question.
Yes, please.
In the decentralized structure, how neighbors are determined? How to distinguish developer and users?
See, developers are hard-coded. Okay. In the program, when you are going to install on your machine, no, that time itself, there are address of developers given.
Participants, please mute your mic. Sir, now you can.
Okay. So in that way, I work on Ethereum, I know in that only. So when we download the code, there itself by default, there are some address given. Those are the developer's address. Okay. In case they call that as the boot nodes. If I don't want to have my neighbor as boot node, I can remove that also. That facility also they have provided. Okay.
Sir, one more question.
Yes,
sir,
please.
How much time it will take to install the current network of Bitcoin?
I never installed Bitcoin. I used only Ethereum.
So, sir, what about
Ethereum, what happens? You have to install some of the prerequisites. Okay. After installing the prerequisite, it will not take more than 10 minutes.
Okay.
See, actually, there is no time. Otherwise, I would have shown demo on Ethereum.
Okay,
and
sir.
Also I don't have now provision to go to my office, otherwise I would have shown.
No issue, sir. We do have sessions on Ethereum tomorrow. Okay. It will be covered there.
Okay, then it's good.
Okay, sir. Okay. On behalf of all the participants and JC Patan, I would like to thank you for your valuable knowledge.
Okay, thank you.
And sir, we enjoyed your session a lot. Hope to see you again in one of such FTPs related to blockchain. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, madam. Thank you all.
Okay, thank you very much.
So can I leave now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.